Hello, anatomy colleagues, this is Dr. Alsup, and in this video, we will be discussing the osteology, or the bony structures we need to know for the spine, hip, and thigh session. Now, this first slide is a review. We discussed each one of these structures towards the beginning of our curriculum, but I'm well aware that that was quite a while ago, so it's time to review them here. The vertebral column is composed of the vertebrae, which is what we're going to focus on, and then all the associated joints, so those intervertebral discs and the joints between any of these processes here. There are five levels or types of vertebrae. The three superior most, so these three are going to be mobile, whereas the inferior most are fused or immobile. So there will be no movement between these vertebrae. There are seven cervical vertebrae, and these are going to be located in the neck region here. And if I didn't count it out exactly, but you know, you were getting the idea here. So the cervical vertebrae are associated up in this region. The 12 thoracic vertebrae are going to be located in this region. And the thoracic vertebrae are the ones that attach to the ribs. And then we have the five lumbar vertebrae. Yep, I counted it right, there's five here. These are going to be the largest of the movable vertebrae, or of any of the vertebrae, really. Your first sacral may be about the same size. But also, these are associated with the lower back. Then we get to the fused vertebrae. You can see the sacral vertebrae here that are forming the sacrum. And then you have generally four fused coccygeal bones that will form the coccyx. There can be some variability in the amount of bones associated with the coccyx. And as you can see, they become a bit more rudimentary the more inferior you get. So this is a lateral view of the articulated vertebrae, and this affords a really nice view of the intervertebral foramina, which you can see basically throughout this whole region here. And I could keep drawing circles till my heart's content, but you can also see this focused in over here on this image in the lumbar region, showing how the intervertebral foramina are formed by superior and inferior notches of neighboring vertebrae. And this is where spinal nerves and primary rami will exit the vertebral column. You can see that close relationship here with an intervertebral disc. Now moving to the coxal or hip bones, and we are going to look at this lateral view of the pelvic girdle here. You can see the sacrum back here posteriorly, because this shows a really nice view of the structures we're going to identify on this bone. I think the elephant in the room, this thing that you can't miss here, is this large prominent socket that is going to be laterally placed. It's called the acetabulum, and this is the socket of the hip joint, so this is going to receive the head of the femur. If you think about the glenoid fossa of the scapula, which is the socket of the shoulder joint, and how shallow that is in comparison to this structure here in terms of the acetabulum, so that fit between the head of the femur and the acetabulum is quite a bit tighter. The greater sciatic notch is located right here. It's a greater sciatic notch. And as its name might suggest, this is a large notch, and it's going to be between kind of the acetabulum region and the sacrum, the neighboring sacrum there. As its name would suggest, the sciatic nerve will traverse the greater sciatic notch, as well as a lot of other neurovascular structures we'll discuss in an upcoming video, but also the piriformis muscle will exit the pelvis to head towards the greater trochanter. And during life, you know, we're going to have ligaments in this general region, which kind of closes this off and makes this a greater sciatic foramen. One last structure I want to note is the ischial tuberosity. And this is located inferior to the acetabulum. It's on the ischial portion of the coxal bone. And it's a notable mounding of bone caused by the proximal attachment of the hamstring muscles. Moving to the femur, and much to talk about here, the femur is the bone of the thigh, the longest bone of the body, and once you've seen it a few times, it's pretty hard to mistake with another bone. We're also looking at a posterior view here, and I'm going to talk about why I know that. So let me tell you why I know that. First off, I can see this region right here called the lesser trochanter. And so this is going to be inferior medial to the greater trochanter. We'll talk about that a bit more in a moment. But the lesser trochanter is mainly visible from a posterior view. And this is the distal attachment site of the iliopsoas muscle, so that powerful flexor of the hip joint. Something else that is only visible from a posterior view is this region right here called the linea. And I'm outlining it on either side, the linea aspera. And this is a line of bone, so kind of a mounding of bone in the shape of a line, running down the shaft or body of the femur. And this is where most adductor muscles of the medial compartment of the thigh will have their distal attachment. Also, I know this is a posterior view because I can see the femoral condyles here really well, much better than I can see it from an anterior view. So all signs point to us looking at a posterior view. Now let's fill in a few blanks regarding the other structures we need to locate. The head of the femur is pretty distinctive. It looks like an almost perfect ball and will always face medially as it articulates with the acetabulum of the hip joint. Just distal to the head is this pinched in area right here, referred to as the neck of the femur. And this is a relatively weak area of the femur. Just look at the size of this in comparison to other portions of the femur. So relatively weak and may be susceptible to fracture. So understanding where the neck is located is important. Opposite the head, so more laterally placed, is the greater trochanter. The greater trochanter is greater, and the fact that it's larger, it's going to have more muscles attaching there. So many, many muscles actually attach here. Three of the more important ones are going to be the gluteus medius, gluteus minimus, and the piriformis. Can't forget the patella, often just referred to as the kneecap or the knee bone. The patella is the largest sesamoid bone of the body. Meaning, a sesamoid bone means that it forms within a tendon, and the patella forms within the quadriceps femoris tendon. You can see the rougher looking anterior surface here, and a smoother looking posterior surface. It's smoother because cartilage covered this area during life for the articulation between the patella and the femur. And last but not least is the tibia. This is the medial bone of the leg. It's also the weight-bearing bone of the leg. And we have this here to discuss the tibial tuberosity. And sometimes you can see it having it go down all the way about there. Basically, it's this mounding of bone on the anterior surface of the tibia, just distal to where to the articular condyles of the knee joint. So the knee joint's going to be formed right here. You go distal to that and you're at that tibial tuberosity. If you palpate just below your own patella, so below your own kneecap, you go a little bit distal to that or inferior to that, you will feel another bump, and that is this tibial tuberosity. This is where the patellar ligament or the continuation of the quadriceps femoris tendon attaches. So some large important muscles are attaching here. Excellent. Thank you for your time and attention. And please always feel free to reach out to me or any of my anatomy colleagues with any questions. Have a great rest of your day.